This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we have a very interesting new look at something very old. A few weeks ago, we looked at the UFO experience in Fatima, and there was another early UFO experience, which we're going to be talking about today, in the 1930s in Italy, that's little known outside of Europe, but it hasn't really taken off much in the United States, and it should, because it's a very, very important event, and it's been brilliantly researched by a remarkable man who you will meet right now. There we go. Here's Roberto Pinotti.
Hi.
Roberto is a very well-established Italian ufologist. You are the... Roberto, you'll have to give me your credentials because I can't find them in English.
No, in Italy, I am the only living founder of Centro Ufologico Nazionale, the UFO National Research Center, established in 1967. So it's rather important since it's a 57 year that we keep on researching and doing our best to let UFO reality known in Italy, and not only in Italy, of course. I wrote up to this moment 65 books about different arguments, but most about the UFO problem. And some of them were also published abroad, not only in Italy. But what is important is that we succeeded in, since 1993, in having an international World Congress in San Marino.
I've been dying to go there since 1993. I've been dying to go to that conference since 1993, and when is it going to be in 2024? Has it already happened?
Yeah, in fact, in a few days, on the 1st and on the 2nd of June of this year, we will have the 33rd edition of this Congress. It's rather important because last year we obtained a remarkable effect. we convinced the Parliament of the Republic of San Marino to be involved in the UFO problem. They discussed this topic, voted, and decided that their government has to present the topic to the next, not this year, obviously, but next year, General Assembly of the United Nations. So this is important, really, because I don't know what will be the result, but it's rather important after all.
Well, yeah, it surely is. And, I've heard so many good things about this conference. And so are you going to do the conference at the UN this year, next year, or is it going to be a separate?
No, event? This year is impossible because due to the political crisis in the government of the Republic of San Marino, since they have their elections the week immediately after the Congress of this year. Then it will be the next government to have to face this subject. But no problem, because their parliament decided this. So yeah. Let's see what will happen.
Well, I hope I get to come to the...
I like to be optimistic.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I don't know, folks, if you heard and saw me sort of moving around. Siri, where is Siri? Here is Siri, decided to join the conversation all of a sudden.
Yeah.
And I hopefully turned Siri off. Normally that does not happen. But Siri was helping me find Roberto's information which I do not need because I have Roberto right here to tell me everything he needs. We need to find out about. Roberto, you started in ufology in Italy a long time ago. What brought you to it in the first place?
Well, it's a long story. I began everything when I was a teenager. And my grandmother was a sort of mentor in this because she was very involved in mysterious things. And so when I was very, very young, 12, 13, I began to be involved in all this. And the first book I did not tell you that my grandmother knew English, of course. And so she began also to learn me something when I was a boy. And one day my father said, okay, but since you are beginning to know something in English, well, come with me. I take you to a library. You choose a book, the book you may be interested in. And so you may try to begin to read it. So this would be useful for your knowledge of English. And I found in this library a book by Morris Jessup, The Case for the UFO. I still have this book. It was a bantam book, a pocket book, and it was published in 1955. And consider that I was born in 1944. I read this book in the second half of the 50s and began to be interested in the topic. And in this book, there were a lot of addresses of people involved in UFO research. So I began to write them. And nobody asked me, excuse me, how old are you? So I began to exchange material, paper clippings, reports, and so on. And so this is the story. The rest is what happened.
It's a great story, and it's such a familiar one in many ways. The usual glitches here. My listeners are used to them, between just strange electronic glitches and my inefficiency with electronics. All kinds of things happen on this show that don't happen on other shows, I'm sorry to say. In any case, this level of interest is often accompanied or begun by a close encounter, but you didn't mention one, so I don't think that happened to you. Now, I'm assuming it didn't. Is that correct?
Well, yes. In my ufological experience as a researcher, as a writer, and so on, well, I was involved on four different occasions directly in UFO sightings in different parts of the world. But probably the most interesting one was in 1978, when in Italy we had, in that year, about 2,000 sightings. It was an incredible UFO wave. And one day, with other 10 people, we could observe a dozen of different UFOs in the skies between midnight and 3 after a.m. And you understand that 3 hours is a long period of time. We saw their maneuvers. They were also photographed by us. Frankly, it's not too interesting because you see, to photograph the night sky, you only see a dot of light and nothing else.
Yes.
It may be useful only to us in order to convince us that we are not dreaming. But this event lasted 3 hours. It was very, very incredible. Imagine something like, for instance, the Phoenix Light, for instance, you understand, in America, something like that. So yes. It was very, very suggestive, yes. Then other single sightings is very interesting. But once in Mexico, I was the consultant for the Swiss Italian television, and for the 50th year of the UFO sightings, they organized a TV program. So we went with this team of the Swiss Italian television to the United States and also to Mexico. And we went also to interview a contactee, a Mexican contactee, Carlos Diaz. Well,
oh, yes.
I cannot tell you anything about him, after all. We just interview him. Okay, I saw UFOs. These are my photographs and so on. Okay. But apart from this, after this interview, that night, since in Tepoztlán, the place in which he lived, well, you may understand that there was no movida in it. We asked, I and the director of the TV troupe, what shall we do this night? And they said, well, here there is nothing to do. Let's go to Carlos Diaz's house. So maybe we may drink something with him. We go, we went to towards his house, and we were surprised in seeing a UFO over his house. The most stupid thing that we did is that we began to observe all this for about 3 or 4 minutes. Then a cry in the night, and the director of the TV troupe said, "The cameras!" Because we did not, we had the TV cameras. We did not think that we could really film this. And before we took them out of the car, everything was over. This is curious. Don't ask me anything, but we saw them.
Well, when we come back from the break, which we're going to take right now, we're going to ask Roberto, what did you see? Because it's quite fascinating. All right, we're taking a break. Wait, Roberto, yeah. We're taking a break. So just be silent for a couple of seconds. Okay, uh-huh. I'll come back to you. So this is now the beginning of the break. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. We're talking to Roberto Pinotti from Italy, his website, robertopinotti.com. We're going to be talking about one of the most remarkable events in the history of UFOs and also one of the first in just a few minutes. But right now, where we were in Mexico, and there was a lot of controversy about the gentleman that you're talking about, Diego, what was his name?
Carlos Diaz.
Carlos Diaz, yeah. And at the time, because some of the UFO pictures he made were rather remarkable, and people were wondering what to think of them. Big red objects sort of hanging in the sky. I've seen some of the pictures, and they're strange. And you saw something over his house, though, which means that there's a level of authenticity.
Yes.
Describe what you saw.
No, it was more or less exactly what he photographed. He called these objects naves de luz, ships of light. And yes, in fact, their form was, they were luminous and orange light, more or less. And the form was a sort of saucer-shaped object, more or less, with a sort of cupola in their upper part, and that's it. Was a single object we saw and nothing else. But frankly, don't ask me why this object was above his house. Frankly, we can't judge him. Frankly, I have my opinion about Carlos Diaz. I'm sure that really he observed real objects, and probably that his photographs are authentic. The problem is that, as many contactees, he also had a story about all this. And as you know, sometimes contactee create a sort of invention about their experience. They say a lot.
I know that very well. Yeah. It's one of the great painful problems with the whole close encounter experience and the contactee experience. I have struggled with it myself for years because it's so easy to slip into story from fact. Exactly. And I agree with you. I'm sure Carlos did that to some extent, because if you're not prepared for it, it's easy to do. Fortunately, in my case, I had my wife, Anne, who was not allowing that to happen, was not going to happen. And she would pull me back every time I sort of went down that path. And I learned how to be really rigorous about it. And some other contactees have too. But if it comes to unexpected, like it came to him, then, you know, things can happen. And they did. But anyway, the photographs are extraordinary. And the fact that you saw that object, which we're showing now on the screen, is remarkable. Because that was so unusual. I'm just making a note for the video editor here. So unusual that I thought when I first saw images of it that it must be a fake, but no. Okay, so let's go on. Those are a couple of remarkable sightings in your adventure, and we're going to explore a little bit. Why do you think it is? And let's go back to Italy now. We were in Mexico, folks. Now we're going back to Italy. And why is it? Italy has a truly exceptionally large number of UFO events. More, I think, even than certainly more than the UK and Germany, by far more than Germany, more than France, I think.
They're
very close, France and Italy.
Well,
why is that?
From an historical point of view, in Italy we had the different UFO waves. The first one was in 1950. The second one was in 1954, and it was at the same time of another important UFO wave in France. It was probably a part of a wider wave in Europe. In any case, it was very important, with about 1,000 sightings in 1954. Then in another important UFO wave was in 1973. And then the most important, absolutely, was between 1978 and 1979, with more than 2,000 sightings. And in this situation, the Italian government had to face seriously the problem, and they asked the Italian Air Force to be charged in this topic. And so since then, since 1979, the Italian Air Force simply is involved not in investigating, but in collecting UFO data. And in this moment, they have on file about 500 official cases. And this is absolutely interesting, because it is an official body of the Italian government, and this is still on.
Now, in Brazil, there were not only a lot of sightings, but also people were literally being hunted down in the forest at times. The story is harrowing. Was anything like that happening? Oh, You know, wait, no, I'm wrong. Or perhaps I'm right. Anyway, we're going to take the second break now. And we'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. All right, so before the break, I was asking you whether or not there had been a lot of close encounter events in Italy during UFO.
Yes, everything began with the 1954 wave, with different close encounters of the third kind. And this was repeated also in 1973 and also in 1978 and 79, but also later, because we had other UFO waves in 1985, for instance, and also towards 2000. But what is interesting, there are patterns in all this. In other words, we have many cases who are extremely similar or identical, even in different moments and in different waves too. And this is extremely interesting because this shows that we are facing something real and not imaginary, you understand?
Yes, exactly. Something very real. And there weren't too many reports of close encounter, were there? Or there were some?
Well, our Centro Ufologico Nazionale, our center, in 57 years of existence, filed about 13,000 investigated cases during the last century. This means that really there are a lot of UFO events. Some of them were masked or quite unknown. You have to look in the old newspapers, so you have to investigate them later. But in any case, this is extremely important because you understand that in spite of what the media publish, the events, the UFO events, occur really, in spite of us.
Yeah, exactly. And the other thing that happens is a lot of people, and it depends very much on the individual culture, a lot of people will be very hesitant to report a close encounter.
Absolutely.
That was true all over the world in those days. And therefore, you don't quite know what was happening. It's interesting that Brazil is a very different sort of culture. Brazilians are much more open to, you know, they're going to make a noise about it if something like this happens.
That's correct. For them, it's normal.
Yeah, exactly. For them, it's normal. And it's how normal. Can we even be saying that? It's remarkable that we would even be saying that, but it's quite true. For them, it's normal. What about more recent flaps in Italy? Have there been some more recent ones, I believe?
Well, I have my opinion about that.
Please let us know.
Up to the first decade of 2000 years, we had different waves. But at present, it seems that waves do not manifest themselves like before. In other words, for instance, before we had UFOs with UFO occupants, absolutely. Now it seems that this aspect is a little disappearing, in the sense that probably we have been watched by remote piloted objects. For instance, what in South America is called flotillas, that is fleets of UFOs, in other words. Well, this is occurring also in Italy and in Europe. It seems that probably these objects are not too big. Probably they are spheres about 1 meter in diameter or something like that, no more. Groups of many of them, and they fly all together, and it's possible that they are simply probes having the possibility to record what may be interesting for these guys up there.
Yeah, the question is, why are, you know, we have to say, why are they here? Because they're here for some reason, and it's always changing. There were big flaps in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Abductions developed in the 70s in the United States, yeah, and various other countries. And then in the 80s, they slowly trailed off. Now it's becoming, there are people in the United States. In fact, I was just on Facebook last night with one of them who was talking about, he was live streaming a UFO over San Antonio, Texas, actually my hometown. And that's not unusual. There's a man named John Martin in Georgia who routinely takes images of UFOs. And there's more than one person in Sedona, Arizona, who actually takes tours out every night to photograph UFOs. And the ones in Sedona are very careful. They have Melinda Leslie knows every satellite in the sky, so she knows when she's got something anomalous. So what's all this about? Why is it changing like this, do you think, Roberto?
Well, it's hard to say, but I think that we may consider a detail. The detail is that there is surely a link between the observers and the objects, in the sense that, for instance, I'll tell you a very curious sighting 4 years ago. We had our World UFO Congress in San Marino, and in 2 days. And the second day, while we are having our Congress, people came into the theater in which we had the event and said, come out, UFOs are here. We considered that this was a joke, but it was not a joke. We went out, and in the broad daylight, we were hovered about 100 different dots of light crossing in the skies altogether. And we filmed them. It was a lot of people who could film this with their phones, no problem. And the question is, why? Well, we were there in order to have our Congress. This event occurred. It was a case. Well, I don't know, but maybe we should consider one thing. If you have a group of people, 300, 400, 500 people, all together thinking altogether the same thing, UFOs, in other words. Well, it's like that you may project outside of you your thoughts. And if by chance someone could have the possibility to feel this, to receive this thought message, if we may call this in this way, well, maybe this could be sufficient in order to manifest themselves. No, why not? Frankly, I am no an answer, but frankly, we asked ourselves why this happened.
Now, are you saying that the thoughts and interest of the people created the UFOs or drew them?
No, that this may call the UFOs, in the sense that the thoughts are some have their reality after all, but a group of thoughts by different people, right, 300, 400, 500 people all together, may be something which may be received by someone. But this is just
exactly. I agree. I'm sure that happens. Certainly happened when there used to be conferences in Gulf Breeze, Florida. Yeah. That would happen all the time. That they would show up. Speaking of showing up, folks, we're going to take another brief break. We'll be right back. And this is the last break, I'm happy to say, for you who are listening on the free side. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there? In the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Roberto Pinotti. His website, RobertoPinotti.com. His book, UFO Contacts in Italy. I believe the volume one is available on Amazon. Volume two, I'm not so sure. Is it available, Roberto, volume two?
Well, really, I have back the rights of the book, and probably I must publish it again. But apart from this, what is interesting is that recently I published in a week, this book will be out in Italy, a new book about the so-called Mussolini UFO. You know, this was USA like this.
Huh? Right. We're getting ready to talk about that. We'll be talking about that in a few minutes, because it's, of course, the main reason we're here. But I wanted to background it very thoroughly, because it's one of the most important UFO cases of all now, because of what you did and what you found, Roberto. You're the one who brought this case forward, and you happened to bring it forward at just the same time that David Grush was appearing before Congress in the United States, approximately the same few months, and therefore it received a lot of notice, but it deserves more notice. And I'm pretty sure, we'll get into it. Let's start to get into it now. Let's go back now to Italy in the early 30s. And what was Italy then? It was a very different place than it is now.
Yes, it was quite different. In the 30s, after 1922, we had the fascist regime. And like all the regimes, of course, the fascist regime did also good things, but at last, of course, we know what happened. Is important to say is that in any case, the fascist state was a dictatorship, of course, and Benito Mussolini was the political leader in charge for this. Of course, nobody could expect that UFOs could be involved at a sort of extent in that period. But now we had to convince ourselves that it was not like this. Everything began when I received by post a letter containing different documents. These documents were contained, and we are speaking of original documents, not photocopies. These documents were contained in a sheet, which is like this, you see, in the hands of His Excellency Galeazzo Ciano. Who was Galeazzo Ciano? Galeazzo Ciano was Mussolini's son-in-law, and also the foreign affairs minister of Italy. And in this envelope, we had a complete report of a UFO sightings occurred in 1936 over the town of Venice and Mestre. And in different pages, there was everything reported. What I may show you here is, for instance, a page of this report. And you see, we have also the drawing of the object like it was seen, an elongated big object with portholes or something like that, emitting two smaller objects. They were saucer-shaped, as you see. This is a complete report made by Italian authorities. So we had the problem to verify if this could have been possible, and we discovered absolutely that it could be possible. Consider that these objects, they tried to intercept them with planes, biplanes, of course, you imagine, and it was useless. But apart from that, the report says also that there were also other cases 2 years before. And all this story, to be brief, reports that the Italian government created a group, a study group, in order to study these reports, because Mussolini thought that these objects could be a new weapon of another European country, France, England, or Germany, of course. And so they created a group called Cabinet RS-33. RS stands for Ricerche Speciali, Special Researchers. And 33 has nothing to do with a year, like we thought originally. No, it is only a code having to do with new inventions and technologies. And this is because this scientific team had the purpose to study the problem from the standpoint of reverse engineering, in other words. Well, then other reports mention that in 1933, one of these objects had a crash landing and in Italy, not far from Magenta, near Milan, in northern Italy, that it was recovered and deeply studied, of course. This group, the Cabinet RS-33, was directed by Guglielmo Marconi, because Guglielmo Marconi was not only the inventor of radio and the Nobel Prize, but at that time he was the president of the Royal Academy of Science of Italy. So it was involved for this. And other people were part of this team, normally engineers, astronomers, and so on. Well, to tell you like things were, we had this material after we studied them, and so that really everything was possible. We had to make forensic analysis, and so the objects proved to be real, really old reports.
Roberto, when you say forensic analysis, are you saying that you analyzed some materials?
Yeah, from no, the we, objects? We not we did this, of course. We had we gave the documents to a forensic expert in the Tribunal of Como, and he did the analysis, of course. He examined the paper, and he has also to ruin some of the documents because he had to verify if the ink, for instance, was really old, like the paper, and so on. And the result that really all this was written in the 30s, no problem at all. What is interesting is that, this forensic analysis was obviously important, but now, apart from what this mysterious sender sent us, and we suspect that in spite of the fact that he did not reveal us his identity, and probably today we think that he is dead, because today he would have to be more than 90. So it's very hard. Probably he had to do with the family of Galeazzo Ciano. And Galeazzo Ciano, by the way, considered that he was Mussolini's, as I told you, son-in-law. He voted against Mussolini in 1943, and this caused the crisis of the fascist regime. The effect that was that, they killed him. But apart from that, you understand, probably he had documents, and these documents are now available. But what is interesting is that they now killed... we found other documents, and these documents were given us before his death by an Italian premier, Senator Giulio Andreotti. And these documents mention all of them, this cabinet RS-33. Also, they say where this cabinet has its experiments. That was a mountain not far from Rome, Mount Sorate, which it was something like Cheyenne Mountain in the USA, because it was an excavated mountain, and inside it there were many researches made, you understand. So now we have something historical in our hands, and this is extremely important. Now, no more than 3 weeks ago, we had an incredible surprise. This year, we have the 150 years of the date of the birth of Guglielmo Marconi. Incredible, but Marconi's nephew was interviewed by General Press in Italy, and a journalist asked him, "Oh, by the way, but someone says that your grandfather had to do with a research team about UFOs. What do you think about that?" And he answered, "Obviously, it was like this. Yes, exactly. The cabinet RS-33. So he confirmed everything. You understand? Incredible. And this has nothing to do, of course, with our investigation. Then there is also what David Grush had recently told in the United States during a Congress meeting, you know, in which he said that he could say that the first recovered UFO was an object which had crash-landed in Italy in 1933, and that it was captured by American troops in 45 and taken to the USA. And this is the story. So everything is fits to the whole story and is also confirmed by more and more details. And this is extremely important because this means that the UFO problem was not born in the USA in the 40s, but more or less in Europe, in Italy, in the 30s. And that this also shows another important thing. The technology was the same. So it's stupid to think that this technology may have to do with another power today. It's incredible. UFOs cannot be Russian, cannot be Chinese.
We've come to the end of the free section of Dreamland, and we will be continuing on with our subscribers and getting into some of the details about the mechanics of this object that was found and what it sounded like, and some extremely interesting things, some ideas I've had about its possible significance. So those of you on the free side, as always, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.